five, four, three, two, one. I am a fugitive slave. I live underneath the Hollywood freeway or the Brooklyn Bridge. Somewhere under the rainbow. My coalition kept warm by blazing barrels of trash, scraps from the cane field. The fast food establishments. I'm on the run, up and down a basketball court and into the bush. Can't touch me. I am a maroon, chilling. High above the smog line and the tourist enclaves, the North Star visible every night, my guide into a Philly groove, the Delphonics. Soundtracks to my most intimate moments. Ain't no stopping us now. We're on the move. Up the Chesapeake and into the Mississippi. Inventing jazz and blood plasma along the way. I'm wearing a hat, a brim, a new attitude, and I'm ready for a new century, so bring it on. Serve it up with mush, crumbs from the table of discontents. I'm going to the great house farm, oh yeah. I'm going to the great house farm. I'm going to the great house farm, oh yeah. I'm going to the great house farm. And I can't decide if I want to wear dreads or a skinhead or an afro or a conch, so I'm shopping for wigs. Do you have the Henry Box Brown look? He was shipped north in a box and wound up with the first flat top. Henry Box Brown. I'm on the run in a white Bronco disguised as an ex-football player. Through the streets of Virginia Beach and into a boxing ring, battering my brother to death, proclaiming victory at the press conference and misquoting some dead leader. I'm a movie star. Gun at the ready, my image plastered on plantation walls next to the malt liquor ads. Drunk on my own infected blood, strong, stronger than the jackass and circus elephant that get more respect than I do. No, I'm not registered to vote. But still I'm running for office, for the Canadian border, for some hovel in South London where I can make a living, a better living than I'm making right now, cutting the sugar cane with this rusty machete. My master is my father, my master, mi master, mi father, father, master, master, father, father, master. Note my resemblance to the $1 bill. Isn't my grimace the same as his? I whipped my overseer, didn't you see it on Cops? I whipped Miss Rosa Parks, she forgave me. I know how to do the Black Panther stomp and the Charleston, 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 and don't forget the James P. Byrd Memorial Texas Hop. Disguise myself as a moonwalking tap dancer, all the while tapping the phone, getting the message out to the barbershops and the lodges, the Howard University School of Law. I never go outside without wearing my root tucked into my right Nike boot. I'm a fugitive slave running in Hitler's Olympics, gold chains and medals dangling on a cover of a box of Wheaties. Constructing ships for my imminent departure. Now moored in the Harlem River or Lake Michigan, when it's frozen over, my kind of town. Quiet, no slave catchers in sight. Just a soft neon glow from the taquerias. Someone wants to sell me a green card. I'm in the Grand Canyon, listening to Bob Marley 8-tracks, smoking the peace pipe with Osceola and the wild Chapatulas, jumping up and down at Mardi Gras and Carnival, and on the 1st and 15th of every month, I'm sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the luxury liners go by, and it's New Year's Eve, and they're playing the blues and Public Enemy, and I'm trying desperately not to believe the hype. All I need is my Thorazine. I'm not a violent person. I'm just terribly misguided. I went into space and blew up. I went into hiding up the McCain family tree. Don't look now. I'm an American slave and I got my own sitcom. What you talking about, Willis? Millions of laughs per century with no commercial interruption. I wear three-piece suits and penny loafers. I've been to Yale and I've been to jail. Trumped up charges, they gagged me. Made me a news anchor on the Titanic, reporting live from a disaster in progress. Swam the shore with Cuban refugees, only to be shipped to Panama, where we swam the canal after we dug it. The Rio Grande, the Nile with Langston Hughes. Caught the mock slave auction in Williamsburg, took a couple of licks just for old time's sake. Gave a couple to show my versatility. Personally escorted President Nelson Mandela throughout the 50 states. I showed him where the Civil War started and never ended. The Underground Railroad, upgraded and retrofitted for the 21st century. Let's just say, President Mandela, that it runs from here to there and it's not a straight path. I'm moving to the beat of bare feet, shackled and perfumed, pedicured for the front row patrons who just love a public execution. Oh yeah, baby, come on one. I ran with Fred. I knew him from the projects. Even back in the day, my boy had his own talk show. He had guests like Nat Turner and Denmark Vesey. Crazy theme song went something like, learning will spoil the best nigger in the world. So let's get spoiled, y'all. That's the word. Here's Freddie. That's how I learned my ABC. Wrote my first book, delivered my first lecture, recorded my first quadruple platinum CD, conferred with Dr. King at the Lorraine Motel. Hey, y'all, I told him to duck. And now I'm at large. My portrait on the post office wall or the cover of Time magazine, a tremendous reward for my capture because I'm one of the world's great men of color. Taught Hendrix how to play Foxy Lady, and yet invisible in my eleganza ensemble, my tuxedo, my butt nakedness at Attica, my tears frozen in some rerun sequence on somebody's telethon, I'm eating my past to freedom. Once it was carefully forged, now digested, my only meal for days, will work for food. And that's the title of my latest poem, scrawled on Henry Brown's discarded box. You know something, people? A liquor company told me that I'm descended from great kings and queens. 40 ounces of black history, anybody? You can't touch me. I know all the black roads and alleys, the best restaurants, how to live high on the hog. I invented chitlins and crack cocaine. A secret lab behind where Thurgood Marshall plotted civil rights and political casualties come to be consoled, where the dismembered get stitched and everything is everything. Doorman to the best club in the world where the passwords are freedom now. Changed my name from Bailey to Johnson to Stanley to Douglas to Ida B. Wells. And yes, Governor Palin, I did pal around with John Brown. Nearly escaped the noose myself. Still running all those European tours, applauded and lauded till they mistook me for an Arab. Got hooked on heroin and bebop. Started my own import-export concern. Got busted for trafficking in literacy. Still doing time on those charges. I guess I should have never preached about David and Goliath or how we need to boycott Denny's. This is written by myself in blood, if necessary. No rest side abolitionist furiously working the laptop on my behalf. Designing my wardrobe, scripting my punchlines. This is written in my mother's milk, stronger than any formula or synthetic decongestant. My voice is my own, no Richard and Willie act here. I write my own music too. In fact, the only tune that I ever covered was a Star Spangled Banner, 1983 NBA All-Star Game, Marvin, remember? fought in every war invented, and then some. And right now I'm fighting for the right to peddle this knowledge on this particular corner at this particular time. Yo, 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 dime bags of truth, anybody? Fugitive in the jungles of Suriname and the hills above South Central, awaiting an earthquake or an insurrection, whichever comes first. Meanwhile, making myself heard on the far end of the dial in between the grunts and groans, the sighs and screams, sirens and helicopters, dogs lapping at my scent, chasing me since what, 1838, up and down Malcolm X Boulevard? Somebody tell me it's just a Spike Lee movie. Somebody tell me why I just fired two rounds into my own reflection like some narcissist gone mad. I've read the classics, remember? Spray painting my name, any name on any wall that will have me, gangsta, rapper, P-H-D. My dissertation lay unread, trampled underneath the crowd as they fell out of Madison Square Garden, or the unemployment office, or the Holocaust Museum, where an 89-year-old white supremacist just murdered a 39-year-old African-American security guard, details at 11. But still I rise from this nightmare called history. Cold sweats in my cardboard box, my concrete crib, my room without a view. Endless days, sleepless nights, punching this heavy bag like Joe Louis, like Ali, like James Brown at the Apollo, out of confusion, out of bondage, up from slavery, up from Maryland, up from Mississippi, up from the gutter in which I'm lying right now, choking on my own filth in the automotive exhaust. Do you see me in your rearview mirror? Now snap into that virtual reality. Look into the future. Am I still preaching the gospel on late night cable? Pushing pancake batter, reading old slave narratives as bedtime stories, putting America to sleep. I've gone underground, way underground. I'm burrowed underneath Mount Rushmore in Stone Mountain, Georgia. I've got an inventory of all Confederate flags and colored jockey statues. Closely monitoring the activities of the brother who took my mom's car keys on Crenshaw, and the brother who put a knife to the neck of my wife on Wilshire, and the brother who put a gun to my head up in Baldwin Hills claiming to be an off-duty cop in search of a stolen bicycle. And the brothers who stomped my friend to death in front of the Hollywood Palladium and laughed. Something about a black leather jacket. Are my references too obscure? Can you follow my drift in the Atlantic? In the Caribbean, in the creek, in chapter 4, in Frederick Douglass's narrative. In an instant, poor Denby was no more. His mangled body sank out of sight, and blood and brains marked the water where he had stood. The deed was done by a religious overseer by the name of Gore. Hell of a baptism. But still I have risen to fight the Negro breaker, Jim Crow. Naysayers and doomsayers, supremacists of every stripe, enemies within my own self-doubt and suicidal tendencies, you have seen how a man was made a slave. You shall now see how a slave was made a man. Armed with two fists, one mind, and a semicolon. Dangerous. Devious. Made it from Tidewater up to Tribeca in one day, feeling as if I'd escaped a den of lions. One of the lucky ones, I suppose. So many more to follow, and so many more to lead the way. Now take me to the bridge. I'm ready. This, testing 1, 2, is a letter to be addressed to Mr. Thomas Auld, A-U-L-D. my former master. Dated September 3rd, 1848. Sir. I have chosen this day on which to address you, as it is the anniversary of my emancipation. And knowing of no better way, I'm led to this as the best mode of celebrating that truly important event. Just 10 years ago, this beautiful September morning, yon bright sun beheld me a slave, a poor degraded chattel, trembling at the sound of your voice, lamenting that I was a man and wishing myself a brute. I was like one going to war without weapons, 10 chances of defeat to 1 of victory, but God's grace was sufficient. My mind was made up. I embraced the golden opportunity, took the morning tide at the flood, and a free man, young, active, and strong, is the result. When yet but a child, about 6 years old, I first imbibed the determination to run away. The very first mental effort that I now remember on my part was an attempt to solve the mystery, why am I a slave? I had, through some medium, I know not what, got some idea of God, the creator of all mankind, the black and the white, and that he had made the blacks to serve the whites as slaves. How could he do this and be a good God? I was puzzled with the question, till one night, sitting in the kitchen, I overheard some of the old slaves talking of their parents having been stolen from Africa by white men, sold here as slaves. The whole mystery was solved at once. And very soon after this, my Aunt Jenny and Uncle Noah ran away. Aha! There were free states as well as slave states. And from this day forward, I made up my mind that I would someday run away. The morality of the act, okay, I dispose as follows. I am myself, you are yourself. We are two distinct persons, equal persons. What you are, I am. You are a man, and so am I. In leaving you, I took nothing but what belonged to me, and in no way lessened your means of obtaining an honest living. Your faculties remained yours, and mine became useful to their rightful owner. I therefore see no wrong in any part of the transaction. Since leaving you, I've occupied stations which I never dreamed of while I was a slave. 3 out of the 10 years since I left you, I spent as a common laborer on the wharves of New Bedford, Massachusetts. 'Twas there that I earned my first free dollar. Whoo! That was a precious dollar to me. Remember in Baltimore, when I used to make $7 or $8 or even $9 a week, you would take every cent of it away from me every Saturday night, saying that I belong to you and my earnings also. You know, I never liked this conduct on your part. To say the best, I thought it was a little mean. So far as my domestic affairs are concerned, I can boast of as comfortable a dwelling as your own. I have an industrious and neat wife, and 4 dear children. Dear fellows, sound asleep now, in their own beds, perfectly secure under my own roof. There are no slaveholders here to rend my heart by snatching them from my arms, or blast their mother's dearest hopes by tearing them from her bosom. These children are ours. Not to work up into sugar and rice and cotton and tobacco, but to watch over, regard, and protect. My dear family, at this moment you are probably the guilty holder of at least 3 of my only sisters and my only brother in bondage. These you regard as your property. They are recorded on your ledger, or perhaps have been sold with a view to filling your own ever-hungry purse. Sir, I demand to know where and how these dear sisters are. Are they living? Are they dead? Have you sold them? Are they still in your possession? You write to me, and you let me know all about them. I would write to them and not disturb you in any way, but they have been deprived of the power to read and write. You have kept them in utter ignorance. And this is an outrage upon the soul and a war upon the immortal spirit. How? Let me ask. How would you regard me? Were I some dark knight, in company with a band of hardened villains, to enter the precincts of your own elegant dwelling and seize the person of your own lovely daughter, Amanda, take her away from her family and friends and all the loved ones of her youth, make her my slave, compel her to work, and I take her wages, place her name on my ledger as property, disregard her personal rights, fetter the powers of her immortal soul by denying her the right and privilege of learning to read and write, feed her coarsely, clothe her scantily, and whip her on her naked back occasionally, and more and still more horrible, leave her unprotected. A degraded victim to the brutal lust of fiendish overseers who would pollute, blight, and blast her fair soul. Rob her of all her dignity, destroy her virtue. I ask you, how would you regard me if such were my conduct? And yet, sir, your treatment of my own beloved sisters is precisely like the case which I have just now supposed. I will now bring this letter to a close. And you shall hear from me again if I shall not hear from you. I intend to make use of you as a weapon with which to assail the system of slavery. And in doing this, I entertain no malice towards you personally. There's no roof under which you would be more safe than mine, and nothing for your comfort which I might not readily grant. Indeed, I should esteem it a privilege to set you an example as to how mankind ought to treat each other. I am your fellow man, but not your slave. Frederick. Douglass. One of the most interesting events of the past week was a holding of what is technically styled a women's rights convention in Seneca Falls, which we attended most eagerly. But many who have at last made the discovery that black folks are entitled to some rights, as well as other members of the human family, have yet to be convinced that women are entitled to any. It's perhaps needless to say that we cherish little sympathy for such sentiments or respect for such prejudices. You see, standing as we do upon the watchtower of human freedom, we are free to say that in respect to political rights or any other rights, we hold women to be justly entitled to all we claim for men. Our doctrine is that right is of no sex. We therefore bid the women engaged in this movement our humble Godspeed. You know, it's been suggested that we rename our North Star newspaper the Brotherhood, but would this not imply the exclusion of the sisterhood? If anything, this paper's gonna be renamed Frederick Douglass's paper. As this man is the owner, the publisher, and the editor. Mr. Editor, if you please. about the time I began this newspaper enterprise up in Rochester, New York. I chanced to spend a night and a day under the roof of a man who made a very deep impression upon my mind and heart. He was first mentioned to me by several prominent black men, and in speaking of him, their voices would drop to a whisper. And what they said of him made me very eager to see and to know him, and fortunately I was invited to see him in his own house. Now in person, he was lean, strong, sinewy. He presented a figure as straight and symmetrical as a mountain pine. Such was the man whose name I'd heard in whispers, and such was Captain John Brown, one of the greatest of all American heroes. After a strong meal, Captain Brown approached his subject. He denounced slavery in look and language fierce and bitter. He said that he thought that slaveholders had forfeited their right to live and that the slaves had a right to gain their liberty in any way they could. He did not believe that moral suasion would ever liberate the slave or that political action would ever abolish the system. He said that he had a plan and he wanted my cooperation. You see, this man, John Brown, he was not averse to the shedding of blood. He said that he had no better use of his life than to lay it down in the cause of the slave. And when I suggested that, you know, we might convert the slaveholders, he became much excited. He said, no, that could never be. He said he knew their proud hearts, and they would never be induced to give up their slaves until they felt a big stick upside their heads. Well, had some white men made such a display, I should have rejected it as affected and false and hypocritical, but in John Brown, I felt it to be as real as iron. Or granite. And from this night spent with John Brown, while I continued to write and speak against slavery, I became all the same less hopeful of its peaceful abolition. My utterances became more and more tinged by the color of this man's strong impressions. While I was speaking at an anti-slavery convention out in Salem, Ohio, I was interrupted by my good old religious friend, my sister, Sojourner Truth, with the question, Frederick, is God dead? No, I answered. And because God is not dead, slavery can only end in blood. Now let's all rise for our national anthem, please. Thank you. Turn it up, please.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the 4th of July. It is the birthday of your national independence and of your political freedom. Fellow citizens, pardon me. Allow me to ask, why am I called upon to speak here today? What have I or those I represent have to do with your national independence? Are the great principles of political freedom and of natural justice embodied in that Declaration of Independence extended to us? Such is not the state of the case. And I say it with a sad sense of disparity between us. This 4th of July is yours, not mine. You may rejoice, I must mourn. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, we wept, when we remembered Zion. For there, they that carried us away captive required of us a song. And they who wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Fellow citizens, above your national tumultuous joy, I hear the mournful wail of millions. My subject, then, is American slavery. I shall see this day and its popular characteristics from the slave's point of view. What to the American slave is your 4th of July? I answer. A day that reveals to him more than all other days in the year the gross injustice and cruelty to which he is the constant victim. To him, your celebration is a sham. Your boasted liberty and unholy license. Your national greatness, swelling vanity. Your sounds of rejoicing are empty and heartless. Your denunciation of tyrants, brass-fronted impudence. Your prayers and your hymns. Your sermons and thanksgiving. With all your religious parade and solemnity, are to him mere bombast, fraud, deception, impiety, and hypocrisy, a thin veil to cover up crimes which would disgrace a nation of savages. Now, I want you to behold the practical operation of this internal slave trade, the American slave trade, sustained by American politics and American religion. Here you will see men and women reared like swine for the market. Do you know what a swine drover is? I'm going to show you a man drover, driving a company of 100 men, women, and children from the Potomac River straight down to the slave market at New Orleans. Now, mark the sad procession as it moves wearily along. Hear the inhuman wretch who drives them. Hear his savage yells and his blood-curdling oaths as he hurries on his affrighted captives. There. Do you see the old man who locks, thinned and gray? Cast one glance, if you please, upon that young mother. Her shoulders are now bare to the scorching sun.
her briny tears falling upon the brow of the babe in our arms. See too that girl of 13. She's weeping. Yes, she's weeping. As she thinks of the mother from whom she has been torn. The drove moves tardily.
Heat and sorrow have nearly consumed their strength. The crack you heard was the sound of the slave whip. The scream you heard was from the woman whom you saw with the baby in her arms. Her speed had faltered under the weight of her child and her chains, and that gash on her shoulder tells her to move on. Follow this drove to New Orleans. Go to the Superdome. Attend the slave auction.
See men examined just like horses. See the forms of women rudely and brutally exposed to the shocking gaze of American slave buyers. See this drove sold? And separated forever. And don't you ever forget the deep, sad sobs that arose from the scattered multitude.
Fellow citizens, I was born amid such sights and scenes. To me, the American slave trade is a terrible reality, and my soul sickens at the sight. And yet you invite to your shores fugitives of oppression from abroad. Honor them with banquets, cheer them with ovations, toast them, salute them, pour out your money to them like water. But the fugitives from your own land, you advertise, hunt, arrest, shoot, and kill. Oh, yes. You're all on fire at the mention of liberty for France or for Ireland, but cold as an iceberg at the thought of liberty for the enslaved of America. You profess to believe that of one blood, God made all nations of men to dwell on the face of all the earth and hath commanded all men everywhere to love one another, and yet you notoriously hate and you glory in your hatred all men whose skin is not colored like your own. You declare before the world, and you understood by the world to declare that you hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, and that among these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and yet you hold securely in bondage 1/7 of the inhabitants of your country. Well, fellow citizens, I will not enlarge further on your national inconsistencies. I mean, the mere existence of slavery in this country brands your republicanism as a sham and your humanity as a base pretense and your Christianity as a lie. You lie. It is a curse to the earth that supports it, and yet you all cling to it as if it were the anchor of all your hopes. Be warned, be warned. A horrible reptile is coiled up in your nation's bosom. The venomous creature is now nursing at the tender breast of your youthful republic. For the love of God, y'all had better tear away, and fling from you the hideous monster, and let the weight of 20 millions now crush and destroy it forever! Pumpkin seeds. We raise a nice lot of pumpkins this season in our own garden. Some of them were very large, deliciously sweet, as yellow as the gold of California. It does us good to look upon these pumpkins and then to partake of them with our dear little ones. But it's not so much the good quality of the pumpkins to which we would call attention as to the great moral that we've extracted from them. You see, the ground was prepared, and the seed was sown, and the plant was cultivated by our own colored hands. And although the soil was American, it yielded a generous return for our industry. You see, from this we infer that the earth has no prejudice against color and owns all the sons and daughters of men and women as its own dear children. Come on. Come on. You can learn wisdom and goodness from our Mother Earth. I'm sure that you're well aware that your humble speaker has been branded as an ingrate because he's ventured to stand up on his own right and to plead our common cause as a black man rather than as an abolitionist puppet. But I hold it to be no part of gratitude to allow our white friends to do all the work while we merely hold their coats. Let me give you a little word of my philosophy. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Those who profess to favor freedom and yet depreciate agitation are those who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. They want the ocean without the awful roar of its many waters. Now, this struggle may be a moral one, or it may be a physical one, or it may be both moral and physical, but it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. Never did, never will. Find out just what any people will quietly submit to, and you will find out the exact measure of injustice and wrong which will be heaped upon us, and these will continue until they are resisted with either words or blows or with both. The limits of tyrants are prescribed precisely by the endurance of those whom they oppress. And in light of these ideas, black folks are going to be oppressed in the North as well as in the South so long as we submit to these devilish outrages and make no resistance, either moral or physical. Men may not get all they pay for in this world, but they must certainly pay for all they get. And if we are ever to get free from the oppressions and wrongs which will be heaped upon us, we must pay for their removal. We must do this by suffering, by sacrifice, and if needs be, by our lives and the lives of others. Remember, my brothers and sisters, who would be free? Themselves must strike the blow. It is civil war! It is civil war! It is civil war! It is civil war! For 20 years and more, we have given our strength, our moral and political influence to increase the power and ascendancy of slavery. And now the slaveholding power comes with sword, gun, and cannon to take the life of the nation and overthrow the great American government. Well, verily, they have their reward. The power given to crush the black man now overwhelms the white man. The nation has put one end of the chain around the ankle of the slave and the other end around its own neck. They've been planting tyrants and are now getting a harvest of civil war and anarchy. The American people and the government at Washington may refuse to recognize it for a time, but the inexorable logic of events will force it upon them in the end that the civil war now being waged in this land is a war for and against slavery. And it can never be effectually put down till one or the other of these vital forces is completely destroyed. The irrepressible conflict, long confined to words and votes, is now to be carried by bayonets and bullets, and may God defend the right. Now, what are you asking me, Mr. Limbaugh? whether or not black men will freely enlist in the service of this country. Look, let me tell you, that depends upon the white men of the country. Yes, the government at Washington must assure them of equal pay, equal protection as soldiers, give them the opportunity of winning glory and honor in common with all other soldiers. Listen to me, Mr. Beck. I know the black men of the North. I know the black men of the South. They're ready to rally under the stars and stripes at the first tap of the drum. Mr. Hannity, just give them a chance. Stop calling them niggers. And call them soldiers. My brothers, 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 my sisters, my brothers, my sisters, my brothers, my brothers, my sisters, my sisters, my brothers. Action, action, action. There is no time to delay. From north to south, from east to west, the sky is written all over. Now or never. Liberty won by white men would lose half its luster. Who would be free themselves must strike the blow. This is the sentiment of every brave black man amongst us. They are weak and cowardly men in every nation. We have them amongst us. They say to you, this is a white man's war, white man's war. This is a white man's war, white man's war. Believe them not. This is your hour and mine. The iron gate of our prison lies half open. One gallant rush from the north will fling it wide, 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 wide open, while 4 millions of our brothers and sisters shall march out into liberty. Do you remember Denmark Vesey of Charleston? Do you remember Nat Turner of Southampton? This is our golden opportunity. Let us accept it. Men of color, men of color. Men of color, men of color, men of color, men of color, to arms! Some men say that they're willing to fight for the Union, but not for the freedom of no niggers. This was especially true of New York City. The attempt to enforce the draft in that city was met by mobs, riot, and bloodshed. There's perhaps no worse chapter in the whole history of the Civil War than this cowardly and bloody uprising in July 1863. For 3 days and three nights, New York City was in the hands of a ferocious mob. And although this mob was nominally against the draft which had been ordered, it poured its fiercest wrath out against black folks and our friends. It hanged Negroes simply because they were Negroes. It murdered women in their homes and burnt their homes over their heads. It dashed out the brains of young children against the lamp posts. Burned the colored orphan asylum, a noble charity right down there on Fifth Avenue. Plundered the building of every valuable piece of furniture. A high carnival of crime and reign of terror. Yes. I know something about the temper of such crowds. But these anti-draft, anti-black New York City terrorists were something more and something worse. But the hour is one of hope as well as danger. And our chief danger lies in the absence of all moral feeling in the utterances of our rulers. You see, in his letter to Mr. Greeley, President Abraham Lincoln told the country virtually that the abolition or non-abolition of slavery was a matter of indifference to him. He would save the Union with or without slavery. And in his last message, he shows the same kind of moral indifference by saying, and I'm going to quote, that he hoped that the rebellion could be put down without the abolition of slavery, end quote. I end where I began. No war but an abolition war, no peace but an abolition peace. The black man a soldier in war, a laborer in peace, a voter in the North as well as in the South. America his permanent home and all Americans his fellow citizens.
Such is my idea of the mission of the Civil War. And if accomplished, our glory as a nation will be complete. Our peace will flow just like a river, and our foundations will be the everlasting rocks. Get on board, little children, get on board. Little children, get on board. Little children, there's room for many or more. Get on board, a little children, get on board. A little children, get on board. Okay, excuse me. Vibrating. Excuse me. It's Harriet Tubman. Hello, Harriet. How are you? Yes. Good. Yes, I'm among friends. Don't worry. Yes. I've been keeping a kind of hotel all summer. Yes, my brother Perry came to me after a bondage of 56 years. Yes, with his family of six. I've been taking great care of him this summer. Yes, he carried me on his shoulder many a time, protected me from the assault of bigger boys. Huh? When I needed defense, yes. Well, you know, Harry, the difference between us is very great. Most of what I have done in the service of our cause has been in the public eye. I have received much encouragement at every step of the way. You labored in a private way. I worked in the day, you worked in the night. The midnight sky and the silent stars have been the witnesses of your devotion to freedom and to your heroism. Listen, Harriet. Listen, Harriet. Listen, I know of no one who has risked more, sacrificed more to serve our enslaved people than you have. Well, most of what you've done would seem improbable to those who don't know you like I know you. As a conductor general on the Underground Railroad. Get on board. Little children, get on board. Little children, get on board. Little children, there's room for many or more. Get on. Little children, get on board. Little children, get on board. Little children, there's room for many more. Say goodnight, Harriet. Goodnight, Harriet. We love you so much. For the moment, my son, Lewis H. Douglass, represents our whole people. Rising up from degradation to respectability and from proscription to equal rights. The principle involved is one for which every man and every woman ought to contest, for it involves the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and it is the business of every American citizen, black and white. Lewis just returned home from the war. Stood on the walls of Fort Wagner, South Carolina, born himself like a man on the perilous edge of battle. And now that the war was nearly over, Lewis returned home somewhat broken in health, but still willing, still able to work at his trade. But alas, he begged in vain of his fellow worms to give him leave to toil. Day after day and week after week and month after month, Lewis sought work. He found none, and he came home sad and dejected. You know, for 16 years, I had printed a public journal up there in Rochester, New York. I had employed white men, white apprentices during all this time, paid out to white men in Rochester, New York, at least, what, $100,000? And yet here was my son, a young man of good character who learned his trade in my office, a Civil War veteran, disabled, and yet unable to find work at his trade because of his color and his race. You know, walking among my fellow citizens out there in the street, I have never failed to receive my due courtesy and kindness. In fact, there are even some men out there who have shown an interest in saving my soul. But of what avail are such manifestations where one sees himself
ostracized and degraded, and denied the means of obtaining his daily bread. Until this half and half condition is ended, there will be a just ground of complaint. You will have an aggrieved class, and this discussion will go on. Until our pathway to the American ballot box shall be as smooth and as safe as the white citizens, this discussion will go on. Until our right to practice at the bar of courts and to sit upon juries shall be the universal law and practice of this land, this discussion will go on. Until the courts of this country shall grant us a fair trial and a just verdict, this discussion will go on. Until the trades unions and the workshops of this country shall cease to proscribe us and to prevent our children from learning useful trades and earning a decent living, this discussion will go on. Until the public schools shall cease to be caste schools, this discussion will go on. Until the American people shall make character and not color the criterion of respectability, this discussion will go on. On and on and on till the break of dawn. On. If there is no struggle, said there is no progress. On and on and on until the break of dawn. If there is no struggle, said there is no progress. On and on and on until the break of dawn. If there is no struggle, said there is no progress. That was a rap about the Frederick Douglass from 1818 to 1895. MC Freddie D, the man is still alive, no jive. In 1985, he was alive. In 1986, you know we threw him in the mix. In 1987, he was looking down from heaven. In 1988, he said, mash down apartheid, smash down apartheid, mash down, smash down, bash down apartheid. In 89, he was right on time. And now it's more than 20 years after the film Do the Right Thing, and I still gotta bust this rhyme. They love black music, but they hate black people. I say they love black music, but they hate black people. They used to love Michael Jackson upon MTV, Eddie Murphy and Mr. T, Bill Cosby and Bob Marley, and Oprah Winfrey and Halle Berry, and Wellesley say to me that they love Spike Lee, but they don't give a damn if we are free. I say they don't know a thing about our history, this history. It was a long journey, and you don't stop. A long journey, and you don't stop. See, everybody used to rap about money and sex, and then everybody started rapping about Malcolm X. El Hash Malik was very unique. He came to I&I right off of the street, but they shot him down up in the Audubon Ballroom. Now they just, what, playing Game Boy on his tomb? Boom, 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 boom. They shot him down, boom, boom. Shot him down because he wore the crown. Malcolm X, y'all, he never played the clown. He was always hoeing down. He wore the crown. Now, the sound. See, I'm not saying that we can't have no fun. That's not my idea of revolution. But please don't forget about Paul Robeson. Big Paul. He was the king of them all, y'all. All American playing ball. Well, that wasn't all, y'all. He was a Phi Beta Kappa Shakespearean rapper. Big Paul stood tall, y'all. Yes, he was born in the USA. But in the same day, they took his passport away. Why? Because I didn't like what he had to say, okay? Like, here I stand, an African American, son of a slave from the cradle to the grave. Are you now or have you ever been aware of him? Understood why they were scared of him, Big Paul. He was the king of them all, y'all. History. It was a long, a long, a long, a long, a long, long journey, and you don't stop until the break of a new dawn. Like Marvin Gaye say, let's get it on. You got to be strong in this your Babylon. In this your Babylon, I say you must be strong. You must be strong in this your Babylon, because you never know yourself until you're back against the wall. Never know yourself until you're back against the wall. Never know yourself until you're back. You're back, you're back, you're back. You're back, you're back, you're back. You're back, you're back, you're back. You're young and you're gifted and you're under attack. You're young and you're gifted and you're under attack. Shot in the back on the Oakland train track. Well, how are we going to deal with that? I say we must fight back. How are we going to do that? We must learn to read. We must learn to write. We must organize ourselves to fight. Fight for what? For our life, y'all. For our life, y'all. I said we're fighting for our life, and that's the death. MC Freddy D will never run out of breath. If there is no struggle, said there is no progress. That was a rapper, brother Frederick Douglass. That was a rapper, brother Frederick Douglass. Now, who do we need, y'all? We need Frederick Douglass. And when do we need him now? Or order. Who do we want? Say we want Frederick Douglass. And when do we want him? When do you need him? Or when do you want him?
Now.
Or when do you need him?
Now.
Or when do you need him?
Now.
Or when do you want him?
Now.
Now, shot in the back on the Oakland train track. But don't forget about the black against black. Against black. Against brown. Against black. Against black. Against brown. Against black. And it's straight against gay in New York and LA, and it's black, and brown against brown, and black, against black. Oh yeah, and I almost forgot, we died fighting against Grenada, Panama, Somalia, Afghanistan, and Iraq. So, where's my peace prize at?
WELLESLEY, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Lighting by Rose. Big up to Rose, one of your colleagues here. Sound by Mark in the booth. Thank you. Yes. Pumpkin seeds, courtesy of Professor Colin Channa. Thank you, Channa. Good to be in the house. Rock and roll. I'm going to have some water.
Wow, that was amazing. I'm just out of breath and trembling from the performance.
Don't tremble, because I'm just your opening act.
My name is Eugene Koh, and I teach here in the English department, but on behalf of the NEWHOUSE Center for the Humanities, I want to thank you for coming, and I want to thank you again for that just mesmerizing performance. Roger has generously agreed to take some questions and talk about the show, but they've enlisted me to initiate the conversation, so I'm afraid I'm going to have to start this by asking a few questions, and then we'll open it up to the audience, and I'm sure you have a lot of things to say.
Rose, could we have some house lights, please? Thank you.
Yes. If we could turn this down, and if we could turn up the house lights, right, so we can communicate with the people in the audience. I think I speak for everybody here in saying that I thought it was profound, mesmerizing, riveting, but like a great piece of jazz or blues, it also induces a certain euphoria. So it was, it's, I'm still staggered by the whole experience. But I did want to ask a question to initiate this conversation. I noticed in early on, you made an allusion to Great House Farm, the song that Frederick Douglass talks about in his autobiography. And for those of you who are familiar with it, he talks about, well, a slave song, and he wonders how it is that a sensitive and intelligent person could listen to slave songs, or essentially precursors of the blues, and think of this as an expression of contentment among the smiling black people in the fields, because for him it's a song about sorrow, and but it also contains this undying fury. And one of the things about Douglass's narratives is that, despite its eloquence, its rhapsodic grandiloquence, you never lose sight of that very prophetic fury. And I wondered if, relative to America today and relative to the world today, whether you think your piece starts from that same space or a similar space.
You know, among other things, I think Douglass was our first American music critic. He constantly placed not just African American music, but all music within a cultural context, and he did it with an extremely articulate and prescient edge. If you notice the speeches, letters, editorials of Douglass that I referenced in this piece, there are many, many musical references. And this is something that I think continued to inspire him. He played the violin. His grandson became a master violinist. So he always had a very direct affinity for musicality. And I do as well. I grew up listening to AM radio, KGFJ, Los Angeles, the Soul Station, the Magnificent Monocue, Wolfman Jack from XCRB, who asked us constantly, "Are you naked?" he broadcast from Tijuana, so he wasn't, you know, he didn't have to observe FCC regulations. The prologue was actually inspired by a passage that beautiful and horrible passage in Douglass's narrative where he recounts the murder of the slave Denby, who had attempted to escape and was shot in the river, and blood and brains is all that remains. I only aspire to work in that same body of inspiration as Mr. Douglass.
Yeah. As a follow-up to this, you know, when you think about, for example, that image of the man whose brain gets unceremoniously blown to bits in the river, and you're told now there's just blood and brains in the river, as I recall. That's an image, that's a narrative, it's a sensibility that you can't domesticate. Blues, would you say it's been domesticated? A blues that came out of that kind of experience? And the reason I ask is that it felt to me that in your piece, you were in certain respects protesting against the domestication of a sensibility that we can trace back to Douglass.
Yeah, domestication is something that is probably better for dogs and cats than for cultural achievement. I think that we constantly have to go to the source material and reference it and listen to it and rewind it mix it. Mm-hmm. And that's what the great achievement of hip-hop culture, I think, has been, to take those rhythms, to take those beats, which are unable to be copywrit, you know, because they are so much connected to our bloodstream, and to make something new and fresh and beautiful and ugly and disturbing from it. Yeah.
And I have to say, your piece was disturbing. When you think of it,
we can get you a Valium. Don't worry.
But when you think of it not as the history of Frederick Douglass, you're not just channeling Frederick Douglass as though we were watching a newsreel, but you wanted to bring him alive now, as in the title, and you wanted, I thought, the audience not only to be inspired, but also disturbed by the piece.
Yeah, I mean, they are disturbing images, and they are images that are not simply nostalgically disturbing. When I say, let's go to the slave auction, let's step up in the Superdome, I know that when I was watching that footage from New Orleans, I thought about the slave auction in New Orleans, as I saw people lined up who had absolutely no alternative but to go into a den of iniquity, into a hell hole called America, in which now Africans are entertaining us playing football with no kind of memory of the misery that transpired there. Happy Mardi Gras, by the way. Well, Tuesday.
On that note, that was just a beautiful, really heart-wrenching rendition of the Star Spangled Banner by Marvin Gaye.
Just that wasn't Marvin, that was me, man.
That was you. You're more talented than I thought. Right.
No, I'm not a good liar. That's the, I think, the most beautiful rendition of our national anthem, which in essence is a martial drinking song, but which was transformed into a sweet slow jam by Marvin Gaye, who was accompanied only by a cassette tape. At the 1983 NBA All-Star Game, showed up at the last minute. They didn't want to let him do it. Dr. J had to intervene on his behalf. And it's especially moving when we know that that was the last time that Marvin Gaye performed in public. And within a year, his father murdered him. We're talking biblical people. To have him introduce the 4th of July's oration, one of the great orations in American history, I think is appropriate.
Can you talk a little bit more about then juxtaposing that rendition by Marvin Gaye with Frederick Douglass's 4th of July speech, right? What to the slave is the 4th of July, right? I mean, and another one with that kind of prophetic, almost Old Testament fury, so blunt, uncompromising in its language, and its frontal assault on the hypocrisy that's behind the Independence Day.
Well, you know, he says in the introduction, you know, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, we wept, and we remembered Zion, for there are they that carried us away captive, required of us a song. And they who wasted us required of us mirth. And here we have Marvin Gaye in the arena singing the national anthem, entertaining, and doing it beautifully. But I think Marvin's connection with the song was in the same tradition as Douglass's connection with the hypocrisy of the American ideal. Douglass called the Civil War the unfinished American Revolution. And his sign off on the war, you know, hey, if we do this, our journey will be complete. And of course, the journey was betrayed during Reconstruction. It was dismantled.
Can I follow up that while we're on that thread with a question that's a little bit more personal, having to do with Spike Lee. I know you've worked with Spike Lee on a number of films, and he directed that wonderful piece that was shown on Thursday, a Huey P. Newton story. Now, you know, of course, as well as anybody else, that Spike Lee is on the one hand an outspoken critic of the NBA, as well as one of its biggest fans. He was doing what I was doing on the night of the Academy Awards, which is attending the Miami Heat Knicks game. Or rather, I watched it on TV. I was flipping back and forth, and there was Spike rooting, you know.
Well, he wasn't nominated for an Oscar this year.
I mean, how do you...
If he had been nominated, I think he would have been in Hollywood.
How do you react or respond to that, to that contradiction in Spike Lee, as well as, well, myself, as so many fans of the NBA who recognize the exploitative relationship that the NBA has to, say, inner city youths, and what it offers as spectacle that we get so into.
I did a film called He Got Game, starring someone you may have heard of by the name of Ray Allen. And in that film, I played a character by the name of Big Time Willie, who kind of broke it down to this character, Jesus Shuttlesworth, what it was going to be like and what the obstacles were and what the contradictions would feel like. And, you know, I think in that monologue that Spike and I devised for that film, we outlined, you know, that very thing that you're talking about, you know, where African people in the Americas, not just in this country, but all over the Americas, are expected to provide entertainment. Some are paid handily, but most are not. And it's an ongoing tradition. And Spike has continually referenced that through films like Bamboozled, More Better Blues, even Do the Right Thing, where Radio Raheem's boombox, i.e. his culture, i.e. his Africanness, is assaulted with a baseball bat. The most American of instruments.
Since, right, American is apple pie, right? Since we're venturing out into other work, some of your other work, would you like to talk about this piece in relation to the whole of your work as
well,
actor,
this,
as
this
writer?
Piece actually began, I think, when I was a child. I was obsessed with the Encyclopedia Britannica. I read it many times backwards and forwards for fun. Thank God, you know, there weren't computers at that time, because I would have never come out of the computer, probably. My mom also had a two-volume set by a guy by the name of J.A. Rogers entitled World's Great Men of Color. And I was obsessed with that book as well. And Douglass's narrative is something that I think stuck with me for a long, long time. And when I was an undergraduate at Occidental College, an American Studies major, and I was looking for an honors project to do my senior year, I thought, combine my interest in biography and history and performance and dive into Frederick Douglass. And I've been working with Douglass materials ever since. Sometimes with sound design, Branford Marsalis has actually played the Star Spangled Banner with me instead of Marvin Gaye. Sometimes with a DJ, sometimes with live percussion, sometimes with projections, you can see it on YouTube. Sometimes with live video imagery of the performance. So it's Douglass is something that continues to grow and transform, and of course Douglass lived to a ripe old age, so I can continue to play him as Hal Holbrook has continued to play Mark Twain since the 1950s. And there was a point in Holbrook's career where he had to put gray in his hair. He doesn't have to do that anymore, and neither do I, really. So I might have to put on a wig eventually.
Can you tell us a little bit more about how this particular piece evolved?
It was commissioned after a number of improvisations in collaboration with filmmakers Ben Caldwell and Wesley Groves in Los Angeles by the late, great Miss Ellen Stewart, founder of La Mama Experimental Theater in the East Village. And she welcomed us to the East Village in 1990. And that was the first time that we called it Frederick Douglass Now. And the day that we finished the run of the play was unforgettable because it was the same day that Nelson Mandela walked out of prison after 27 years. So, and Ellen came out and rang a bell on the stage. And it was a beautiful moment. And we to imagine that we had had some sort of contribution to that moment, that we all had contributed to that moment, to see that man emerge from that kind of degradation to build a new South African nation, non-racialist, non-sexist, anti-death penalty. Yeah.
Well,
truth, reconciliation.
Perhaps this is a good time to open this up to the audience, since I know you want this piece to really reach the audience and have an effect on them. So please feel free to raise your hand. I believe there are microphones going around. So if you'd like to pose a question, please feel free.
Yes, go ahead, please.
First of all, I want to say thank you because I'm just totally overwhelmed by your amazing performance. As someone who works in fighting against modern-day slavery, I'm a board member of Polaris Project, named after the North Star, of course, which was co-founded by my son in 2002, and today it is one of the leading anti-human trafficking organizations in the U.S. and in Japan. We operate the National Human Trafficking Hotline. And your
what's your web?
I will give you some materials after.
No, please, announce it.
It's www.polarisproject.org, and the National Human Trafficking Hotline, which anybody can call into, both for information and also to give tips, is 1-888-3737-888. It's a very easy number to remember. I just wanted to say how much your piece resonates with what is going on today in every country in the world, in every state in the United States, in every city in our country, including right here in Boston. And I was just wondering what your feelings are And when you perform this piece, though of course you're thinking about the past, but the present is also very present in it. Yeah. To what degree in your mind you are connecting with the what I consider probably one of the worst forms of human rights abuse today, which is modern day slavery and human trafficking.
Thank you for your comments and for sharing your work with us. The greatest enslavement universally is the enslavement of the human imagination. We look at the theater as extracurricular, as something which is on the side that we can have if we can afford it or if we have leisure time. But I would suggest that theater is an essential process of human engagement. And when we are disconnected from it, I think we have a tendency to fall into a kind of psychic incarceration in which we are not allowed to dream, to protest, to play the villain, to play the hero, to look on a stage, to look in a circle around a campfire and see ourselves reflected. This is the degradation against which Douglass fought, against which Polaris continues to fight. The enslavement of the human mind. Douglass, in his amazing letter to his former master, published publicly on the 10th anniversary of his escape, talks about, yes, physical degradation, yes, enslavement, yes, putting somebody on a ledger, but perhaps his greatest outrage is that his siblings were not allowed to read or write. That they had no connection whatsoever with the liberating essence of literacy. This is, I think, one of the great challenges of this work, of your work, of our work, to re-engage the freedom of imagination in all its forms.
Hello, I'm a senior. My name is Amanda, and I'm a senior here at Wellesley.
I didn't think you were a senior citizen.
I know. But my question is, you talked about so long as the educational system is a caste system, we're still fighting. So I was just curious, what are the tools that our generation have or has to keep the good, to keep fighting? What are the tools that we can use in this generation to ameliorate some of the issues that were still going on back then and are still going on now today?
I think that, again, the struggle for literacy is something which is going to be even more important as we become more electronically bound. We have students who are at colleges like Wellesley who don't know how to construct a paragraph because they abbreviate They abbreviate in text form, so they have no knowledge how to spell words and to even think about constructing a paragraph. And that's not just coming from an old English teacher, which I am. That's coming from someone who was interested in people communicating in the highest possible form. And to construct a term paper to know how to use a footnote is not simply an exercise in grammar. It's an exercise in communication and serves one for the rest of one's life, hopefully. So, there you go. That's important. That's really important. As we do the Twitter, as we do the Facebook, as we lose, you know, as we lose that, we need to fight to get it back.
Hello.
I'm Brian. And really love the way that you took us into how fierce it is to live now. It's good, really good. And I'm wondering about your long work with Frederick Douglass and his relationship with William Lloyd Garrison and what they had and what you found and what you see in that long relationship.
Thank you for that mention. We are here in Massachusetts, so. It's always good to do Douglass and to speak about Garrison. When Douglass said in one of the speeches tonight, I'm sure you've heard by now that your humble speaker has been branded as an ingrate because he's ventured to stand up on his own right and to plead our common cause as a black man rather than as an abolitionist puppet. He was referring to Mr. Garrison. Now, Mr. Garrison discovered Douglass at an anti-slavery rally. Douglass made what, by all accounts, was a brilliant extemporaneous address. Douglass never remembered anything that he said. He was terrified, he said. And Douglass, of course, became one of the great speakers in the employ of the Massachusetts Anti-Slavery Society, one of their great attractions. And in fact, one of the reasons why Douglass published his narrative is because people would come to the rallies and hear Douglass speak, and they would start doubting that he had ever been a slave, because he was so brilliant an orator. So he had to publish this narrative to prove that he in fact knew places, knew people during his enslavement in Maryland, which made him vulnerable to the Fugitive Slave Act. So he had to get the hell out of here, go overseas. He toured England, Scotland, Wales, Ireland, and it was there that Douglass, in essence, purchased himself from his master. Now, William Lloyd Garrison didn't think that that was a good idea because he thought that that was acknowledging the slave contract, that it was somehow legitimizing it. And Douglass simply saw it as a practical means of living. He was born in this country. He had family in this country and did not want to live his life in a kind of luxurious expatriation. So going against the Garrisonians, he purchased his freedom from his master through a fundraising campaign overseas. He also raised funds to create his own journal, the North Star. Again, against the wishes of the Garrisonians, who felt that he should be writing under their masthead. So we see this, again, biblical break from the man who, in essence, was the godfather, who brought Douglass into the abolitionist movement. But Douglass, being the independent person that he was, had to break away from Garrisonian abolitionism. There were also more complicated debates about the Constitution. Was the Constitution anti-slavery or inherently pro-slavery, et cetera? Yeah.
Yes, Mr. Smith, I enjoyed your...
Hey. Hi.
I enjoyed your repertoire tonight.
Thank you.
And when you say, when you speak about the enslaved mind, I've encountered some years of the enslaved mind in quite an extreme, and I'm in the process of writing a book. So I am giving some information to this young lady here with the hope that you get that and move that along, and also if it all respond to me as well. Because it's going to be a beautiful thing, a book of self-healing, to relieve the enslaved mind so that the next generation will be free of that as well. Because to be enslaved in the mind, we're not going any further. We just keep reiterating generation after generation, and we die and we leave off that way. And we need to be free of that, the way that we think, the way that we're being conditioned to think. Okay, and that goes with the art of exploitation and victimizing people and things of that nature. Okay, release of the silly mind, quote and unquote. I forget the name of the author, but there's a book called The Silly Mind, which is a beautiful book. And thank you very much. It was imperative that I came over here tonight, and also to make sure that you get this information as well. And be blessed.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm blessed by your presence and your comments and your contribution to the evening. Thank you.
Hi, I wanted to follow up with some of the other questions. You talked about many aspects of Douglass. Could you talk a little bit about Douglass, the ambassador, the internationalist? You talked about his time in Europe, but how did his experience as first ambassador to Haiti influence?
Frederick Douglass in 1861 was frustrated with the way things were going in the United States. And he was so frustrated with the first Lincoln administration that he was considering wholesale emigration to Haiti. And he actually bought tickets to go to Haiti. But this thing happened in Charleston, South Carolina. Fort Sumter was fired upon in April of 61. And he immediately saw that as an opportunity to wage an armed struggle for the liberation of the slaves. And so he didn't go to Haiti. Fast forward a couple of administrations, and Douglass was sent to what is now the Dominican Republic, to Santo Domingo, to investigate the possibility of annexation of the Dominican Republic to the United States of America. And one's initial reaction to that would say, oh, okay, so Douglass was participating in the imperialist mindset, manifest destiny. But Douglass saw it as a strategic move because, of course, the Dominican Republic shares the island of Hispaniola with Haiti. And he saw that there was a potential to have an anti-slavery stronghold in a strategic spot in the West Indies. Because, of course, at that point, Cuba was still a slave-holding country. They did not abolish slavery until 1888. That didn't happen, obviously, although it certainly happened in the major leagues. We have all the Dominican baseball players. So we've annexed all the great Dominican baseball players. He was then engaged as, ambassador to Haiti. And it was not a great experience for him because he was there ostensibly to represent American imperial interests. And he was constantly fighting for Haitian sovereignty. And came back to the United States not having had the greatest of experiences, and was constantly struggling to have the Haitian Republic recognized as a legitimate government.
Hello. I'm a sophomore in high school, and I was just wondering, do you bring this to high schools? Because at my high school, we have African American history. You can take it as a senior, and there are so many people in my school that just don't know anything about their history. It's a mainly African American community, and they just know nothing of their history. They know, like, the Harlem Renaissance, and that's about it. They know they were slaves, and now they're here. And it's just, I was just wondering, do you bring this to high schools?
Of course I've performed this in high schools, and I have to receive an invitation to yours, and I would love to be there with you and share this with you. In the meantime, there's lots of good excerpts. In fact, there's the entire performance that I did tonight is on YouTube, and it's at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. So before I get there and do it live, you can tell your classmates to check it out on YouTube.
It's much more powerful live.
Well.
I think Margaret has a question.
Hi, Roger. One of the things I love about this and also all your work, especially the Huey P. Newton story also, is the way you mix the old and the new. The mix itself is to me what, you know, alluding to Bob Marley, rappers, you know, just things that are very new. I think one of the things that make really appealing to young people.
Well, Douglas was the original rapper.
Well, I was going to ask you about that, because it seemed to me that, you know, it also gives the work that sort of slightly disturbing.
Thank you for coming. Excuse me. Thank you for coming. Thanks for bringing the kids out especially. Have a great weekend. Okay.
Yeah, it's late for him, right?
Yeah, it's bedtime. I'm sorry.
Yeah, so it's that, the mix itself, you know, it makes me think of the, you know, Sugar Hill Gang and Jay-Z and those people, that gives it also that provocative edge, I think. And so I was going to ask you what Frederick Douglass would think of this kind of mix.
Well, I don't know what Mr. Douglass would make of all this. I think that Douglass would definitely be a man of the media, because he was at that time. I mean, I can only imagine, you know, the power of Douglass, who might have access to email, who might have access to a Facebook page. I mean, this is a guy who was knocking out speech after speech after speech, editorial after editorial after editorial. You should look at his travel itinerary sometimes. He didn't have a car. He went in wagons on horseback all over, particularly this part of the country. The editorials that he knocked out day after day after day, how did he do this? It's fantastic to imagine how one man was able to construct all of these ideas. You know, the 4th of July address, which was not done on the 4th of July, it was done on the 5th of July because they refused to acknowledge the 4th. It was done on the 5th, actually, 1852, Corinthian Hall, Rochester. The first time he did that, it was probably 3 hours in its entirety. I distilled it to maybe 8 minutes or something, 9 minutes. We don't have that kind of, you know, tolerance for public speaking. These only Castro and Farrakhan, you know, speak that long now. So, you know, I don't know what he would, I don't know what he would make of it. He'd look at this thing in my hand and say, "What is that?" Because, you know, from all reports, he had an amazingly resonant voice. And he would probably look at this venue and say, "This is a piece of cake to project to the back row." And now you have this instrument that you can just put in your hand to make your voice, you know, project like that. I don't know. Go ahead. I think you're kind of anxious.
Yes.
Give this woman a microphone, please. Yes.
We want anxiousness.
Given the constraints in current American society, would Frederick Douglass be in jail?
Mumia's in jail. Frederick Douglass was in jail. He attempted to escape from slavery, was caught, beaten severely, dragged behind a wagon, and was imprisoned. That didn't stop him. As we know, he was given a root by his brother Sandy that he put on his right side and said, "If you keep that on your right side, you're not going to be whipped again." And he had an infamous struggle with his overseer, Covey, and whooped him, and was never, they didn't lay a hand on him ever again. And he escaped to slavery, to liberation, nominal liberation, because he was always fighting in the North as well. I think it was in Boston that he held on to a streetcar seat so firmly that they had to disconnect the entire seat and throw him out holding on to it. Those are the kind of physical struggles in which he was engaged. So would Douglass be in jail today? You know, no, Douglass is not in jail. Douglass is here living in the hearts and minds and struggles of all these people here at Wellesley College, including yourself. So Douglass is not in prison. Douglass is free. And that's why we didn't charge anything to come to the theater tonight. But we are charging you to get out. And the only price that you have to pay is your imagination.
Maybe on that note, we ought to finish the evening, end up the evening with, let's send Roger off with one final round of applause.
Thank you. And I must applaud you as well, and thank you so much, Wellesley community, for welcoming me. It's been an extraordinary week Colin Channer, Kara Doherty, Jane Jackson, thank you so much. All of our newfound colleagues here, thank you so much. I'll be around and we can do a fist bump or two. Thank you.
Okay.
I would like to stop by and see you because of something you said about Spike Lee. You said that.